Got started in the afternoon here.
Try to keep us on time as much as possible.
So just a quick question, and see if I can get a quick poll. We have a break scheduled between our second and third talk in the afternoon, and in past conferences, people have typically voted to just kind of go through the break and to try to finish a bit earlier. Would that be okay with the audience?
Yes.
All righty. It's never a really hard question to ask, but I do have to ask. So to start off the afternoon, I'm really excited to have our next speaker, which is Kristen Piskulich. She's going to be doing, giving us a talk, really from a nursing perspective, but really being on the floor with brain injury patients and how to manage, not only manage brain injury, but manage a lot of the emotional reactions that as healthcare providers, specifically nurses who have the tough job of spending 24 hours with these patients a day and how to manage that. So I'm really excited to have her start the afternoon for us and get us past the post-lunch kind of slowness to our day, if you may. So a little bit about her. She has been a nurse for 21 years. It's actually a second career for her. She's a social worker by training initially. She received her bachelor's in social work from Kansas State University and her master's in nursing from Webster University. She is she's certified in rehab nursing with her CRN, and she's a certified nurse executive through the ANCC. She's worked in all specialties, including ICU, pediatrics, and behavioral health, but really her love has been med-surg nursing and leadership. She's worked in some facet of leadership for the past 28 years and is currently the chief nursing officer at SSM Rehab in St. Louis, which is one of our sister hospitals through Select. She wanted to say that she lived her entire life in the Midwest and incredibly excited for March Madness, even though Kansas State has sadly been eliminated, but she's not going to root for Kansas University. So she wanted me to state that. So with that, I ask you to welcome Mrs. Piskulich to the stage.
To the team at West Gables for inviting me to come down to this beautiful city and escape the rain that is in St. Louis right now. So I wanted to just take a quick poll. How many nurses are in the room? Do we have nurses in the room?
Yay!
All right. I wanted to talk, have my talk center a little bit more around nurses. I realize that all of us work in some facet, therapy or nursing, with our brain injury patients, but I wanted to take a little bit of time and spoil nursing a little bit. But hopefully what you'll get out of my talk will be applicable to all specialties. So how to manage the stress and find success. I have no industry relationships to disclose, no products or product usage is going to be discussed. So I wanted to look at brain injury patients' unique challenges that often can create a stressful work environment for nurses. We're going to talk a little bit about strategies on how to tackle those behaviors and how to make meaningful connections with our patients. I really truly believe that's the hallmark of our profession in nursing is how do we connect with our patients. And finally, touch a little bit on compassion fatigue. I don't know if that's something that you're all aware of or if you've heard it. It's kind of a buzzword right now, but it's very, very real. And I want to talk a little bit on how to maintain a healthy practice as well as having some work-life balance. So yes, my shift is starting, I'm ready to go. Do we all feel this way when we go to work? Well, as a nursing leader, I love when my staff feels that way. But we all know that once you get to work, you get report, and then you find out you've got a brain injured patient. And not only do you have a brain injured patient, but it's one that's been impulsive, has been a challenge all day, and that nurse giving you a report looks completely worn out. So then the question is, how am I going to get through my next 12 hours? I know I've felt this way. I'm sure you all have as well. So our brain injury patients. Let's talk just a little bit of history, how big the problem really is. So 3.5 million Americans suffer from a traumatic brain injury each year. 52,000 deaths, one-third of all are injury-related deaths. It accounts for almost 250,000 of hospital admissions each year. 80 to 90% develop a disability. It accounts for 1.3 million ED visits. I thought that statistic was pretty staggering. And as you all have heard a lot in the media recently, concussion is a huge one right now. And it's estimated at 3.8 million occurrences each year. So some prevalence in the United States, 35% of traumatic brain injuries are due to falls. It's about 17% are due to a motor vehicle accident. About 16% are due to an external cause of being struck or hit, again, including those sports-related injuries. 21% is unknown, and they say about 10% is related to some sort of a crime or an assault. Age groups. So children up to 4 years of age, falls are the leading cause. Adults that are older than 75, falls are the leading cause. And we know working in rehab that falls is something we all worry about and are concerned about each and every day, every second that we're at work. Gender, it's 1.4 times higher in males than females. And male deaths account for 37,000 and females 13. So it's definitely something we see more in males. Three different classifications. Most of our TBIs are mild, 75%. These are folks that are going to have some temporary effects, but those repeated injuries definitely can be cumulative. So again, think those concussion, those football players, those people that continually are getting bumped in the head. Moderate, they can have some good recovery, but most of them have learned compensation techniques on how to make it through the day. And then really the smallest pod is your severe TBIs. And they can make some improvements, but we know these are patients that are often going to have long-term residual effects that they're going to have to learn to manage. So you all know this, but every brain injury is unique. Every person is unique. Everybody's brain is different. So we really want to look at the type and extent of a primary injury, and then is there a secondary injury and the complications that come with that. So the impact of brain injury, we know that it affects every part of a person's body, which really makes it, I think, that much more of a challenge for nursing. It obviously affects their functional mobility, their ability to self-care, how independent are they. Family dynamics, huge. So how do families manage these patients when they come to us and when they leave us? It's definitely an economic impact. They have body image and self-awareness issues, as we learned about earlier. Cognition and behavior are huge. It affects their sexual expression, which is a big piece of who we are. It can affect sleep. It can create sensory loss. They're confused. They can become disoriented. Communication, that's a big one, right? That's what we depend on to take care of our patients, is being able to communicate with them. And then obviously difficulty with attention and concentration, which again makes these patients a huge challenge to work with sometimes. So nursing management is not easy. This is probably one of the toughest patient populations I personally have ever worked with. And for nurses especially, we have to look at lots of different areas and be able to manage that all systemically in order to take care of our patients. And I think with nursing, which is a little different than therapy, is that we do have to manage all those body systems that are connected to the brain. And there's a lot of systems out there. You know, with therapies, they're concerned with specific muscle groups and speech. But with nursing, we really have to think head to toe with these patients. So just some examples. From a neurological perspective, we have to worry about their arousal and their sleep-wake cycles. We have to worry about how they're responding to medications. We want to promote a recovery of consciousness, and that can include making sure there's familiar scents and sounds around them, tactile stimulation, pictures. We want to try to create that comfort zone for them. We have to monitor these patients for overstimulation. Oh my gosh, we know that they can be overstimulated like that, and which can snowball and create lots of other problems that we're dealing with. And then we have to monitor for signs and symptoms of ICP. Again, that can be life-threatening if we're not picking up on some of those cues right away. Respiratory, gotta breathe, right? So we have to worry about signs and symptoms of hypoxia. We have to monitor their airway, their oxygen saturations. Some of these patients we get are trach, depending on if it was a huge traumatic motor vehicle accident, and they come to us dependent on an airway. Might include some pulmonary toileting. These patients are almost always on some type of aspiration precautions. So we've got to worry about their airway. Their heart, We have to monitor for potential side effects of stimulants and how medications are affecting these patients. And then much like a spinal cord patient, these patients are at risk for autonomic dysfunction. And we have to be able to really pick up on the signs and symptoms of that very quickly. Their nutrition and their hydration. These are patients that we're going to want to monitor their weekly weights. We want to make sure they're drinking enough and they are staying hydrated. Lab work is going to be important for these patients. And then just how are they getting nutrition? Are they getting liquid nutrition? Are they on some kind of a feeding tube? And are we monitoring how that is all making it through their GI system? Their musculoskeletal system. We have to worry about heterotopic ossification for patients that aren't moving like they should. They're at a high risk for contractures, tone, spasticity, as we learned earlier, foot drop. These patients might require splints, casting, all kinds of adaptive equipment. And we need to make sure that we're paying attention to their skin. These patients can be at a high risk for a compromised skin. They could have incisions if they've had multiple surgeries when they come to us and they've got staples and stuff still intact. They aren't moving around a lot. These are high risk patients for skin breakdown. We want to look at a need for specialty mattresses, potentially get a wound care consult right off the bat, and then be proactive, not reactive. And this is something that I'm very passionate about as a nurse leader. I talk to my nurses all the time, if you even think there's a risk for skin breakdown, get them on a specialty mattress before. Don't wait for them to get red before we start reacting, and then we put all these interventions in place. The damage is done. And I believe nursing, we own patient skin. Their sensory perceptual environment, we have to monitor how are they responding to stimulation, because again, we know these patients can get overstimulated within seconds. We want to assess for comfort. We need to pay attention to the temperature of their room. We need to pay attention to, are their clothes too tight? Do they have a device on? Again, much like a spinal cord patient, that we need to worry about that autonomic dysfunction and the risk for that in these patients. We want to be assessing these patients for pain. They may not be able to always verbalize pain, but we need to make sure that we've included that in our assessment as well. Bowel and bladder. Is this everyone's favorite thing to talk about in nursing? I feel like I hear about bowel and bladder all the time, but if you think about it, it's such a basic need, right? We all have to maintain our bowel and our bladder, and these patients are certainly at high risk to have issues with bowel and bladder. So we have to monitor INO very, very closely. We have to make sure, again, they get enough hydration. Is their nutrition good? Do they need a bladder protocol? Are they a patient that's having some incontinence issues that we need to be toileting them every couple of hours to try to get them back on track? Same thing with a bowel regimen. It's very important to learn what their bowel habits were like prior to their injury. And then as much as possible, as nurses, we try to get them back to some sense of normalcy with that. Communication and behavior. So we need to assess for any vocalization or verbalization. Sometimes these patients can vocalize and communicate their wants and needs, and sometimes they can't. So it becomes really important to pay attention to those nonverbals. Utilize any assistive devices, picture boards, how you use the whiteboards in the room, coming up with a plan with the family on how are we going to communicate with this patient. We have to make sure that we allow for adequate processing time for responses. And this is something that I think is sometimes difficult, especially with maybe some newer nurses, is that communication piece, because we're so tied to our phones and technology. We want instant answers, instant responses, because we gotta go here, and we gotta go here, and I gotta see that patient, and I don't have time to sit and wait for this patient to give me a response. So it's something we need to be cognizant of when we're trying to communicate with brain injured patients, is having those natural pauses when we talk to them, because it may take them, much like a stroke patient, 30 seconds to be able to verbalize what it is they're trying to say. And then again, I can't say this enough, monitor for signs of overstimulation. If they're getting restless, if they're getting agitated and fidgety, we want to try to recognize those behaviors sooner than later. So I talked a little bit about autonomic dysfunction. Again, much like a spinal cord patient, we have to worry about this with some of our TBI patients. And what it is, it's an episodic overactivity of your sympathetic component of your nervous system. So first, there's a stress somewhere within the nervous system that's creating a physiological response that can be life-threatening. It can be unexplained fever. It could be their heart rate's going up, their breathing rate's going up, their blood pressure's going up. They get very diaphoretic. They start posturing. It could be something as vague as they're just getting agitated. and we need to pay attention because these kinds of things can be life-threatening very quickly. So for nurses, we need to pay attention to this and look for those triggers. We need to see, is it that their clothing is too tight, that they've got a device somewhere that's pinching them, that's causing this, and be able to make those modifications and recognize it very, very quickly and prevent any complications. And then we also want to make sure we're pulling the family in, because when these patients go home, we want to make sure that the families are very in tune to these triggers and when to call for help. Safety. This is huge with our brain injured patients, right? We always want to assess them for a risk of aspiration. These patients are at super high risk for infection. They could be nutritionally compromised. Again, come to us with multiple surgeries, wounds that are trying to heal. We want to make sure that we secure tubes and lines because these patients we know can be super impulsive and not really cognitively aware what they're doing. So they're going to be pulling and yanking on things that we don't want them to pull and yank on. These patients may need padded side rails, low beds and floor mats. Again, as a leader, I always tell staff, if you think your patient needs that low bed, do it sooner than later. Get it on the floor with a mat so that if they roll out, they don't have very far to go and they're not going to injure themselves further. Obviously, these patients need frequent rounding. I think the norm most anywhere you go is hourly rounding, but we know that BI patients need 15-minute rounding sometimes, 30-minute rounding sometimes, depending on what's going on with them. So kind of breaking it down by discipline, I didn't want to leave out the therapies. So PT and OT. Those patients, when they're with PT and OT, they're going to have a lot of pain, right, during those sessions, any of our patients, regardless of what has happened to them. They're probably going to be experiencing some pain when they're working with the PTs and the OTs. So it's recognizing that with the brain injured patients as well. They're also in a busy, noisy environment, the gyms, right? The gyms, you know, where I work, I know where you guys work, are super busy places, and it is a ripe environment for a brain injured patient to get overstimulated. It also is an environment where they can get frustrated very easily. They're trying to walk some of these steps, they're trying to complete this exercise with the therapist, and they aren't being as successful as they want to be, and they're gonna get really frustrated. Speech therapy, again, patient frustration, maybe not being able to verbalize or vocalize what the therapist is asking them to do. And then just proximity, if you think about it, speech, you're like right there with the patient. You don't have normally a lot of natural body space between you and that patient. And that, again, could be a trigger for a brain injured patient, could cause them to be overstimulated and agitated very, very quickly. So for nursing, we have unstructured time frames, as we talked about earlier. So we know our patients get 3 hours of therapy a day. Well, that leaves 21 hours left in the day that they're going to be with us as nurses. And as nurses, we are multitasking all the time. We generally have 7, 8, sometimes 9 patients. We're trying to answer lights. We're going all over the place. We have to worry about interactions with other patients, with other staff that's calling our phone 50,000 times, it feels like, during a shift. We have families and visitors that are coming in that are asking us and needing us and pulling us in all kinds of different directions. We're interrupted constantly. Our priorities are changing all the time depending on where we're at. We could be starting our rounds and we get to the third patient and we realize, oh my gosh, their tachycardia, something's going on. And then the next hour you're spent with that patient, you still got six or seven other patients that you're trying to manage. So for the patient, they've got some risk points as well. Again, high fall risk patients. These patients sometimes tend to wander. And do we have a safe place for them to wander? Do we have a plan for them where they're going to go and how we're going to manage their need to be moving all the time? Lots of times these patients are high risk for seizures. We just had a patient a couple weeks ago that was in the gym, had a major seizure in the gym, and I think it threw everybody for a loop because hadn't had any seizure activity before. But it kind of scared everybody, and the patient ended up being okay and recovered from it. We called a rapid response, and we kept the patient. We didn't have to send them off. But again, brain injury, high risk for seizures. These are patients that can self-inflict harm as well because cognitively they don't always understand that if they're hitting something hard, it's going to bruise. If they're pulling on a tube, that's their airway. We have to pay attention to those kinds of things. And then a physical assault from another patient. Sometimes brain injured patients, as we know, if they get agitated, they don't have a filter. They don't realize they just can't go and push another patient out of the way or push the nurse out of the way. So for us, we know we can get a little bit of verbal assault. Assault's probably a strong word, but if you've ever had a patient come at you with a ooh and a bunch of words and you're like, whoa, it can be a little bit scary, especially if they're a big 6 foot tall male that's stronger and bigger than you are coming at you with words. Again, physical assault, I know I've been shoved, I've been pinched. I had a staff member about a month ago that the patient just wrenched her hand so badly and twisted her that she was out of work for a couple weeks getting therapy on her hand. Needle sticks, you know, we still have to draw labs on these patients. It's a patient that needs a liter of fluids or their counts are dropping, we've got to transfuse some blood. Someone's got to stick this patient, right? And most of us don't like to be stuck even when we're cognitively intact. So you try again having a large patient that's brain injured. So always important to have a buddy with you when you do that. And then back musculoskeletal injuries. We know, again, trying to manage these patients, sometimes we forget to protect our own bodies and how we're transferring and trying to de-escalate them. So some environmental strategies to think about is to increase structure for these patients. These patients do much, much, much better if there is a structure to their day and there is some predictability that we can build into what that day looks like for those patients. Even if, they, again, cognitively they don't quite understand that, it's that structure and repetition that really will help them develop a better routine. We want to decrease interruptions. Again, keep them on the schedule. We want to keep noise and distractions to a minimal because they are highly distractible. So the more we can decrease the stimulation and create a quieter environment for them, I know it's hard in a busy hospital or in a busy PT/OT gym, but these patients really do better if we make sure that we provide those times where there is a low stimulus. We want to provide them space for wandering, green space, visibility. I don't know if all of your hospitals have rec therapy, but sometimes those folks are wonderful to get your patients outside just to get the sunshine on. I've seen patients de-escalate like that just by getting them outdoors and letting the sunshine on for a few minutes. And then we always want to do a safety assessment. We want to make sure that their rooms are safe, objects are secure. There's not a lot of things that they can grab and throw or get their hands on that could hurt them or a visitor or a family member. And that's something you have to pay attention to every shift because I've seen family members come in and then they go and you go in the room and you're like, well, where'd that come from? And they brought all this stuff in from home that really is way too much for them in their room. And to me, it's just another way that they can get into things they shouldn't. So having an expertise in traumatic brain injury really is critical. We are a specialty in rehab, every bit a specialty, just like oncology and telemetry and neuro. We are a specialty in rehab, and we need to make sure that we're providing our staff the training and the education to properly care for these patients. We want to make sure that staff understand that everything they do can really affect how patients do react to them, whether it's their facial expressions, their movements, their eye contacts. It's making sure that they are comfortable and begin to identify what those triggers are. If you've never worked with a brain injured patient before, this isn't stuff that just is innately natural to a nurse, I think, to think about. And we always want to be intuitive in our practice. Go with your gut. I say that all the time. If your gut's telling you something, pay attention to it. So we want to make sure that we're establishing a relationship based on personal connection. Again, like I said at the beginning, I just feel like our mission as nurses is to make meaningful connections with our patients. We want to bond with them. It's really important for brain injured patients to have consistent caregivers. And this is something that I think is a huge challenge as well, because if you have brain injured patients, especially those that are so difficult that wear you out at the end of the shift, you have nurses coming to you saying, please don't schedule me with Bob tomorrow. I need a day off from Bob. Or you've seen the list where we're rotating the patient every shift, everybody gets a turn. Normally, I would say that's not a bad idea, but for a brain injured patient, it really is. Because as challenging as they are, providing that consistency to them can make a huge difference in how quickly they're able to get on the right track. Observe patterns of responsiveness according to the time of day. Again, it's getting to know your patients. What are their behaviors like first thing in the morning? Do they do better before a meal or after a meal? Do they have issues at night? Are they sleeping all day long and then they're up all night long? provide calm, clear verbal support, and explain to them and keep to a schedule. Support their sleep-wake cycle and track patterns. Note factors that might precipitate agitation. Again, I cannot stress enough how important it is to try to keep these patients up during the day. If we let these patients participate in therapy, and let's say their therapy's broken up, and we allow them to go back to their room and then nap between all of those therapy sessions, what's going to happen? They're going to be up all night. And then you've got your poor coworker on night shift that's walking into a mess because this patient is up all night long, restless, getting agitated, and that, you know, we're trying to have everyone else sleep. They've got 8 or 9 patients. It just isn't a good idea. And then as nurses, again, we have to be little mini social workers as well. We have to make sure that visitors that are coming, they're not triggering action. Sometimes family members, have we all been in that situation where the patient's doing great all day, and then the one family member shows up, and all of a sudden, chaos ensues. So we have to be able to identify that and really work with those families, identify, you know, if they're triggering a certain type of behavior, encourage them to maybe step away for a few minutes so that you can, patient can have some time to calm back down or decrease the stimulus in the room. It might be making contracts with some of those family members. Hey, they do so much better in the morning. So if you want to visit Bob, could you come before 3 o'clock? Because really after 3 is when Bob struggles with being overly stimulated, and it's just not as good of a time to visit. So as nurses, we have to pay attention to all these things. But of course, we can't do it all by ourselves, so collaboration is really important. On any kind of a team that you work with, we have to be able to work well together. In our hospitals, we use a multidisciplinary approach. It's all of us. It's caseworkers, social workers, nurses, PT, OT, speech, the physicians, our neuropsychologists. It's all of us working together and having trust and a mutual agreement on how are we going to care for this patient, what is our plan. Obviously, safety is always first. We have to talk about feedback, modification. If we start on a treatment plan and we're going this way and we're finding that it's not working, we need to really pay attention and listen to each other in our team meetings and make those modifications as necessary. Handoffs are incredibly important with brain injured patients, making sure that what went on for your part of the shift and what things worked for you on the shift, passing that off to your friend that's coming on for the next 12 hours is critical. I'd much rather, if I walk in and I'm like, oh my gosh, I've got this patient that's a little scary sounding, if I had a nurse passing off to me very specific things that worked for this patient, to me I'm like, thank you. That's going to make a huge difference because you already have some tools in your toolbox then to get started. And then family buy-in. Again, we have to pay attention to the families as well. Pick up on the cues, the dynamics, because ultimately our goal is for these patients to go home, right? And we want the families to be successful and to feel comfortable and confident in their environment to take care of these patients. Consistency, 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 consistency. It's the key to working with these patients. Most of them have an impaired short-term memory. We know that. They're going to learn by doing. We want to keep their schedule, again, as simple and concise and structured as possible. We want to keep our goals simplistic at the beginning, making sure that, again, the goals are across all disciplines. As we learned earlier, we have to be on the same page with these patients. Pattern instruction, reinforcing the right thing to do each and every time with these patients. And again, as much as you all cringe, consistent caregivers. If you've got 4 or 5 staff that do really well with a particular patient, it's going to behoove you to continue to have those people take care of that patient. And then feed them lots of chocolate and lunch and things when they're off work to take care of them. So I want to talk a little bit about some specific behaviors, and I know we touched on this earlier this morning as well, but I wanted to, again, reiterate the fact that as nurses, we have to pay attention to all of this as well. So we know impulsivity, tendency to act suddenly and spontaneously without planning or thinking. You know these patients right off the bat within about a minute of talking to them. So we have to make sure that, again, they're in a safe environment. We want to inform the patient when we see behaviors that are not what we want to see to try to help them get into more of a routine. If it is a situation where there are some natural consequences, we want to make sure that we're talking to our patients about that. Cue our patients to slow down and to think about what they're doing. And again, that's hard because as nurses, we are running 1,000 miles an hour trying to manage everybody at the same time for 12 hours. So that slowing down is sometimes really hard for us to do. And then we want to make sure that the patient knows how to be safe as cognitively as they can, how to be safe, how to use their call light. What kind of rooms are we putting them in? Are they close to the nurse's station? Are they on a locked unit? We have to pay attention to all of that. For separation, this is a difficulty switching from one topic or task to another. They're stuck. I'm sure you guys have all had patients like this. We had a patient, Sarah, a couple months ago, 19, actually had an anoxic brain injury. But Sarah was fixated on the elevator, no matter what we did. I gotta go downstairs, my mom's in the lobby. I gotta go downstairs, my mom's in the lobby. And no matter what you did, she just paid, I gotta go downstairs, my mom's in the lobby. Have you had patients like this and you're just like, okay, we're exhausted, who's gonna watch Sarah for a while? Because I work in a smaller hospital, 35 beds. We do have the ability to lock down a 6-room area, but it's super small. So we hate to shut those doors because it really makes you feel kind of boxed in. So how are we gonna manage Sarah? Distraction. Distract, distract, distract. And I know this is easy to say and not always easy to do, but that's when you get with your buddies and you all take turns distracting Sarah, whether it's verbally, acknowledging that she's got a concern, redirecting her. What worked with us is we always acknowledge, yes, your mom's waiting for you. However, we have to do this first, and then I'll take you to see your mom. We have to eat lunch, and then we're going to go and talk to your mom. Hey, we're going to go do your therapy session with Susie, and then we're going to go see your mom. And that's kind of, and her mom was there all the time. But on the few times her mom wasn't there, she was convinced she was on the elevator waiting for her. Physically, again, guiding, redirecting her. And we don't ever want to argue with these patients. We don't want to overly rationalize with them because, again, so many of them, the frontal injuries, they can't rationalize. So it's being specific, having a plan, and just redirecting them. Disinhibition, we touched on this early as well, is an inability to self-monitor their thoughts, their feelings, or their actions. So we want to try not to laugh or encourage behavior, and I'm sure everybody's been in a situation where a patient has said or done something that is pretty hilarious, and you're like, oh gosh, don't laugh, don't laugh, don't laugh. It happens, we're human, but we really want to try to be mindful of that, and our body language as well around that. We don't want to judge them, they can't help when they have those kinds of behaviors. We want to intervene immediately. We want to keep them safe. We want to describe the behavior to the patient, and that should be part of their care plan as they're moving along through treatment. We want to try to hopefully begin to have them understand or know what the natural consequence is. And even have them try to describe the behavior and why it was inappropriate. And I realize not all patients will get there, but some do, and it's a great goal to always have on the care plan or the treatment plan, and to be talking about how that's going in team conference. Demanding behavior. Has anybody ever had a demanding patient? No, right? Hey, I didn't sign up for that in nursing school. They're unable to delay their needs. They always need attention. Nothing you do seems to fix it or take care of what it is.